a bus kid from a broken home, a public high school teen, a chapel member, homeless man, a sailor overseas. So many pieces of our hearts we invest today with those we serve and teach and love. And now it's time to say,
Pastor Brian Johnston from Gospel Light Baptist Church in Richmond Hill, Ontario. I'm excited that we're going to be having Brother Caleb Caviness presenting his ministry and preaching for our service tonight. I began to hear about him a couple years ago and then did some research, watched a video online of him presenting his ministry and so on, and got real excited about what the Lord has called him to do in the Republic of Congo in Africa. He's a young man who's just excited about the work of the Lord, and you'll see that when you hear him talk and so on, when you hear him talk about his ministry. And he wasn't able to come to our church because of the border closing, but we're going to show you a video tonight as he talks about his ministry, and then we're going to share a message that he preached recently in his home church. And I hope that these will be a blessing to you tonight. God bless you. Thank you for watching our service tonight. We encourage you to share it as well on Facebook so that others can see as well. Have a good night.
As he said, my name is Caleb Caviness. My wife, Kelci, is over here. And I started Deputation single. So this is the first big answer to prayer that God brought me. And I started Deputation single, and I said, "Dear Lord, please help me not finish Deputation single." And he brought her to me. So I had the privilege of growing up in a pastor's home. And, you know, I hear a lot of different testimonies, but I'm the youngest of five kids, and I got to grow up in ministry loving every second of it with my family. I started going soul winning on a backpack on my dad's back. And I got to grow up, and I never felt like the ministry stole my dad from me. I felt like it was our favorite thing to do together. And so just a privilege to get to grow up in a pastor's home and as a pastor's kid. And we loved every minute of it. And my dad's pastored up in Oregon for over 25 years now. And just the privilege of getting to serve God as a team. And I have my dad's a pastor, my brother's a pastor, I have two sisters on the mission field, another sister's back working in our home church. So God has spread us around the country. And we have loved getting to serve God, even though we're all over the world, getting to serve God together. And getting to message each other and hear what God's doing in this country or that country. And it's just so exciting to see God work and to get to be a team as a family. God really started burdening my heart when I was, really before I was saved, God started burdening my heart for the world. And I didn't, even as a little kid, I loved hearing the missionary presentations. As a child on Saturday, October 16th, just a little bit ago, Saturday, October 16th, 1999, I knelt in my living room between my dad and my mom and accepted Jesus Christ as my Savior. And not long after that, God started breaking my heart for the need in the world. And I would sit on my bed and I'd spin the globe and close my eyes and put my finger down and open my eyes in whatever country it was on. Usually it was in the middle of the ocean, I'd have to spin again. But whatever country I'd land on, I'd spend that afternoon praying for. And God just started breaking my heart for missions. When I was 9 years old, we had a missionary come through our church. And he wasn't going to Republic of Congo. But in his presentation, he's going to a different country in Africa. But in his presentation, he made a statement. And I was sitting in the second seat in the front row right there. And he said, even other countries in Central Africa, like the Republic of Congo, have been without a single church-planting Baptist missionary for years. And God just pointed his finger at me and said, I want you to change that. I want you to do something. And from the age of 9, God has been sending me to Congo and been burdening my heart, and I've been heading that way and excited to get there. Immediately, I started reading and researching and trying to find missionaries that were there, and very quickly, I found out that I couldn't find any. I couldn't find anyone. And the way Congo works, you can't just grab a tourist visa and go visit. So when I was 19, I got to spend a summer in Uganda working with some missionaries there. Brother Keith Stensis is one of the guys I got to work with. But I still hadn't found a way to get into Congo. And I had some other missionaries that were in neighboring countries I was trying to go to, and it just seemed like the doors kept closing. But my senior year of college, God just brought me in contact with a hospital in the northern part of the country and a doctor there. I'd never met anyone there before, never heard of anyone that had gone to the country, much less this hospital. But I got the email address of an American doctor who'd been in the country for over 20 years and started emailing him. And as a senior in college, I said, will you please let me come over and work at the hospital? Will you get me a visa and let me come over and work at the hospital? And he said, well, what medical experience do you have? Oh, I've had stitches. I broke an ankle once. I don't know if that counts. And I just said, look, I'll do construction. I will sweep. I will do whatever you want me to do if you'll just get me over there. And he agreed. And when I graduated college, I had a few months. And then I was off to Congo. And to be honest, I spent my first week in the country without anyone that spoke English. It wasn't like they picked me up from the airport. I had to get up to the hospital, which is in the northern part of the country. My first phrase I ever said in Lingala was, Sokyo lingi pesangai mapamoko, which means, please, can I have a piece of bread? And I was just trying to figure out how to live and do things. But when I got up to the hospital, the doctor looked over at me and said, well, what are you going to do when you're here? And I said, I'll do whatever you need. And he said, would you like to watch a surgery? Okay, why not? So about 2 in the morning, there was an emergency C-section, and I hear over the radio, Caleb, Caleb! And they called me to what's called Le Bloc, the operating room, and I run over there, and it was about 90 degrees at 2 in the morning in the operating room. We're gowned, masked, gloved. Our humidity's so big, the glasses are fogging up, and I'm going to be honest, I made it about 5 minutes, and I started doing one of these, and then I passed out, and they were all laughing at me. But when I got up, the doctor said, that's a good try. We'll do it again tomorrow. What? But he started working with me, started teaching me and training me, and God just started opening doors, opportunities I never expected. I had the opportunity to be first assist on over 40 surgeries, deliver babies, C-sections. I really liked broken bones because I did construction through high school, and lining things up and slapping some screws in, that made sense. But God just started opening doors. But I say all that, God knit my heart with that doctor. And by the time I had left, he had agreed to sponsor us back into the country, not to work at the hospital, to plant churches. But the exciting part is he's going to work with us to get what's called a religious registration. And the way Congo works is once we get this, not only can we continue to come in long term and not have to rely on anyone else to get our visa, but what we're excited about is this would allow us to invite other people to come in and work and open the door And I believe God has cracked open this door for us. And we're so excited to get there. And God is just doing incredible things. You know, 20, 30 years ago, someone had to do this for Kenya, for Uganda, really 30 to 40 years. These places, they did similar processes we're trying to do right now. And you look now, and there are hundreds of missionaries in these countries. And it's our prayer that in 20 or 30 years, you'll look at Congo, and you'll see hundreds of missionaries in Congo. Because here's what I know. If we can reach the Congolese people, they can go wherever they want. They can go across the river into Democratic Republic of Congo. They can go to Gambia. They can go north to Cameroon. And they can cross the borders. They don't need the same paperwork we need. I believe if God could start a work in Congo, he could reach Central Africa with the Congolese people. So we're so excited about the opportunity that God has opened for us. If at this point we could watch that video presentation.
Imagine a place where whole people groups live as slaves to a rival tribe. Imagine facing the 60% chance you will bury a child before they reach the age of 5. Imagine living and dying with no knowledge of a God who loves you. Imagine being cursed and rejected by your family and friends for turning away from the spiritism of your tribe. Imagine facing loss with no comforter, life with no purpose, and death with no hope. For over 5 million people in the Republic of Congo, it's not imagination, but reality, and it is all they have ever known. Though billions of dollars of foreign aid have been poured into the Congo, it has only highlighted the fact that true hope is not found in a program, but in a person. My name is Caleb Caviness, and God has called me to bring the glorious hope of the gospel to the Republic of Congo. Though several missionaries have gone to neighboring countries like Cameroon and the Democratic Republic of Congo, the Republic of Congo has been without a single long-term Baptist missionary for over 25 years. It has truly become a forgotten field. In the fall of 2016, God opened the door for me to spend several months in the Republic of Congo. For the time that I was there, I rented a small room on the property of a hospital in the jungle town of Mfondo. I used this opportunity to begin learning Lingala, which is the heart language of many of the Congolese people. One evening, just after dark, a man and woman rushed into the hospital carrying their 3-year-old daughter. She had a severe case of malaria, and she was dying. As I walked toward the small building that served as an emergency room, I heard the mother begin to wail and saw the father walk out of the room sobbing. He slumped to the ground and put his head in his hands, and I knew that he had just lost his little girl. As he sat on the small sidewalk by himself, I sat next to him searching for something to say, something that might shine a small light into the blackness that surrounded him. In broken Lingala, I pieced together the only phrases I could think of. I am so sorry. Yesu amwana na pasi na yo. Jesus sees your pain. Yesu alingi yo. Jesus loves you. As I said this, the man slowly lifted his head and looked at me through his despair and asked, Nani Yesu? Who is Jesus? For every soul seeking hope, for every person seeking comfort, my desire, my burden, my mission is to bring the answer to that question. Who is Jesus?
I wish I could stand here and tell you that I looked over at him and explained exactly everything Jesus was to him and what Jesus had done for him and everything that God the Father had done for him, but I didn't know enough language then to tell him. I sat there almost speechless, just, I don't know what to say. But people ask, why are you going to Congo? Why does God want you to go to Congo? It's because I believe that our Heavenly Father is looking down at a country of people who are asking, who is this Jesus? And He wants them to have an answer. He sent His Son. He has done everything that needs to be done for them to have a relationship with Him. But how shall they believe on whom they have not heard? And it's our privilege to get to go to the Republic of Congo and answer the question, who is Jesus? I remember going out in the northern part of the country, way back into the jungle. We'd take these canoes way back in as far as we could through flooded jungle, and we'd get out and we'd hike through thigh-deep water back into these pygmy villages. It's the Aka tribe. And we were going, there's a group from the hospital going to treat them with leprosy. We saw a lot of leprosy over in these tribes. And one of the things you should know about the Aka tribe is that if you're born Aka, you're born a slave. Every one of them is owned by the Bantu tribe, the larger tribe there. And I remember kind of squatting down with a group of these Aka children out in the middle of nowhere. These are people that have nothing. And I remember holding up my phone to take a picture with a group of kids. And there's this little 9-year-old girl that was next to me. And when she saw herself on my phone screen, she got this look of wonder. And she reached out and she kind of touched the screen, and then she touched her face, and then you see this just look of awe and this huge smile, one of the biggest smiles I saw in my time in Congo. And I started asking questions, and I realized it was the first time in her life she had ever seen herself. She'd never seen a mirror. She'd never seen a picture of herself. Closest thing is her reflection in water. And I thought, this is what we're going to do. We're going to a country, and for the first time, we're helping them see themselves as God sees them. This girl will spend her entire life being told she doesn't matter, that she will never amount to anything, that she doesn't matter to anyone, that she's worthless. But we get to go, and as the Bible says in Acts 26, to open their eyes and to turn them from darkness to light and from the power of Satan unto God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and inheritance among them which are sanctified by faith that is in me. We get to go and for the first time help these people see themselves not as their culture sees them, not as the world sees them, but as a Savior that loved them and died for them sees them. And it is a privilege to have the opportunity to spend our lives telling people about Jesus and helping them see that there is a Heavenly Father that wants a relationship with them, that has a plan for them. God works in His time. It's so amazing how He works. My first Sunday back from Congo, I met my to-be wife. My first Sunday back, their family joined our church while I was in Congo. And God just brought her to me in His timing. It was so amazing to see how He worked that. One of the first things we connected on was medical. My wife is a nurse, and she was mad at me because of all the things that I got to do that she wouldn't be able to do here. But God just worked things out in His timing, and we're so excited to see the doors God is opening. We're about halfway done with deputation. Lord willing, we'll be leaving for language school in the end of August this coming year. If you would pray with us that we'd not only be able to raise our support by the end of August, we're also praying that the Lord would provide the $35,000 needed for housing and tuition for a year of language school in France. And so we're praying that we can get there, get that done, and then, Lord willing, when we get to Congo, we'll be starting in the capital city of Brazzaville. And we'll be starting not just planting a church, but the first 2 years, most crucially, we'll be learning Lingala and getting that down. But also, if you pray that we would be able to get that registration and that we wouldn't miss the opportunity. God has opened so many doors already. I truly believe He is paving a way to see something amazing happen in Congo. I know that there's a country of people that are open, that are hungry, that are searching for the answer to the question, who is Jesus? And I believe that our Heavenly Father is ready for them to have the answer. And I believe that more than just us going, He's calling people there right now. I'm happy to say the first missionary that I've been able to hear of, that I know, that's gone to the Republic of Congo, got there a month ago. And the Lord opened the door through this hospital. I got to get him in contact with this hospital, and they got him his visa. He's been there for a month. We're seeing people that are God's working, God's calling, and I believe that God wants to do something in the Republic of Congo. If you would pray with us, I'm so excited to see what God's going to do. But there is a nation of people who need the answer to the question, who is Jesus? And we're praying that God would get us there so we can bring the answer. Thank you. In Acts chapter 17, you have a missionary story. I love the book of Acts because it's pretty much a collection of missionary stories. And that, as all of you know, that's what's near and dear to my heart. And I love reading this passage because you have the Apostle Paul, outside of Jesus Christ himself, maybe one of the best missionaries and the most studied missionaries in the Bible. And you have the Apostle Paul on one of his missionary journeys. If you look down with me in verse number 1 of Acts chapter 17, we pick up kind of in the middle of Paul's second missionary journey. The Bible says in verse 1, "Now when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where was a synagogue of the Jews. And Paul, as his manner was, went in unto them, and 3 Sabbath days reasoned with them out of the Scriptures, opening and alleging that Christ must needs have suffered and risen again from the dead, and that this Jesus, whom I preached unto you, is Christ. And some of them believed and consorted with Paul and Silas, and of the devout Greeks a great multitude, and of the chief women not a few." This is a pretty good start for any missionary. He comes to Thessalonica, and he immediately starts preaching Jesus Christ. He starts giving the gospel. And immediately he starts seeing this result. He starts seeing people listening, people hungry and open, people getting saved and wanting to know more. What an exciting start for a missionary journey to Thessalonica. But in verse 5, you see a little bit of a turn. The Bible says in verse 5, "But the Jews which believed not, moved with envy, took unto them certain lewd fellows of the baser sort, and gathered a company, and set all the city on an uproar, and assaulted the house of Jason, and sought to bring them out to the people. And when they found them not, they drew Jason and certain brethren unto the rulers of the city, crying, These that have turned the world upside down are come hither also." Now, if you stop there, for sake of time, you have people getting saved, and then, as always happens, Satan starts to fight back, and the Jews are getting riled up, and they don't want to see these people pulled away from the synagogues and pulled away from their teaching. And so they fight back. And so they're coming to bring Paul and Timotheus and Silas out, and they're really trying to kill him. And if you look down in verse number 10, you see Paul has to actually flee for his life from Thessalonica. Bible says in verse number 10, "And the brethren immediately sent away Paul and Silas by night unto Berea, who coming thither went into the synagogue of the Jews." Now I can imagine at this point, Paul might be a little bit frustrated. Mm-hmm. Paul might be thinking, this is not how I wanted this to go. I wanted to continue preaching in Thessalonica. I wanted to see people saved, and it was going so well. I'm a little frustrated, maybe even a little bit discouraged, that I had to leave right in the middle of everything going so well. And so now he gets to Berea, and as Paul always does, as soon as he gets there, he starts preaching again. Look at verse 11. The Bible says, "These were more noble than those in Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness of mind and searched the Scriptures daily whether those things were so. Amen. Therefore many of them believed, also of honorable women which were Greeks, and of men not a few." And so we go back right into the same cycle of Paul preaching, people getting saved and receiving even more readily than they did in Thessalonica. Pretty exciting.
Right.
And then right after that, the Jews that are in Thessalonica hear that Paul is 47 miles away in Berea. And they hear that what happened in Thessalonica is starting to happen in Berea. And they're not happy with that. They're not willing to let that happen. And so the Jews in Thessalonica send Jews to Berea to chase Paul out or to try to kill him. If you look in verse 14, the Bible says, "And then immediately the brethren sent away Paul to go, as it were, to the sea, but Silas and Timotheus abode there still. And they that conducted Paul brought him unto Athens, and receiving a commandment unto Silas and Timotheus for to come to him with all speed, they departed." Verse 16, just the first part, the Bible says, "Now while Paul waited for them at Athens." And stop there. Let's pray. Father, we love you so much. I pray that you would use this passage. I pray that you would help us to learn, you would encourage us, but you would also challenge us from this story of Paul. I pray that you would work in our hearts and that you would give us something not just to think about, Father, but something to do from this message. In Jesus' name, amen. I looked at that passage. Now, while Paul waited at Athens, everything was going well in Thessalonica, then he had to leave. Everything was going well in Berea, and then he had to run for his life. And then when they took him to Berea, it's a 20-mile trip to the sea, and then a 250-mile trip by sea down to Athens, which they did with Paul alone. And then they have to do the return trip to get Silas and Timotheus, and then the return trip again to bring them back to him. So Paul is by himself in Athens for anywhere from 8 days to 3.5 weeks, if they went as fast as they could go, to get his companions. I can imagine, sometimes it's easy to think of Paul as superhuman and super Christian. But if he's anything like me, or any one of us, I think, he's probably asking a few questions in his heart at this moment. He's probably thinking, Lord, why is this going this way? And as my dad has always told me, in missions, it's a lot like fishing. When the fish are biting, you don't leave. And I think when Paul's probably thinking, Thessalonica, man, people are getting saved. In a sense, the fish are biting. And the Bible tells us in 1 Thessalonians 2, we see how much Paul wished he could be back in Thessalonica, seeing those people saved, discipling them. 1 Thessalonians 2, verse 17, the Bible says, but we, brethren, being taken from you for a short time in presence, not in heart, endeavor the more abundantly to see your face with great desire. You see, this letter, it's believed that he wrote this letter to the Thessalonians from Athens. And he's in Athens wishing he could be back and see their face, wishing he could be back there. And then he goes to Berea and he has to leave. You start to wonder if Paul's asking, why is everything going wrong? This isn't what I would have planned for a missionary journey. If I could have got down and got my legal pad out and marked out exactly what my missionary journey was going to look like, see people get saved, try to almost be killed, run for my life. Leave them without anyone. Okay, see people get saved, run for my life. Left alone in a city that I wasn't even planning to be at right now anyway. This isn't how I would have planned it, and I'm sure Paul is probably wondering, amen, God, why am I here? What's going on? Yeah. You know, there are some times where things don't go as you plan them to go. I remember being in college, and just in college, I got the opportunity to lead a band called Missionary Prayer Band. It was about 200 college students that voluntarily met every single week to pray for a missionary and a country. And we would have a sermon, and then we'd all get together and we'd pray for a little over an hour for a missionary and a country. And I remember my senior year, first semester, right around midterms, I got a call from my friend Nathan, who was helping lead that, and he said, hey, our speaker for tonight dropped out. Would you consider preaching for us tonight? And to be honest, I was working two jobs then. It was midterms week, and I hadn't slept in over 70 hours. And my first thought was, not a good option, not a good thing. My grandpa always says, preachers always need to be ready to preach, pray, or die. But at that moment, I wasn't. And I said, let me pray about it, I'll get back to you. He said, okay, well, it's 4 hours away, so pray quick. And I got on my knees, I said, God, it was one of those prayers where you're kind of letting God know that he probably should say no, and then asking him what he wants. Lord, you don't want me to do this, right? And I got on my knees and said, Lord, I've been working this long. I'm so tired. I've got all these projects due. Do you want me to preach to the Missionary Prayer Band tonight? And after praying, I truly felt like that's what God wanted from me, that God wanted me to preach that night. I thought, Lord, if you want me to, I will, but you're going to have to give me the message. And I kind of cleared my day and got my Bible out and I started studying. I got up that night in Missionary Prayer Band, huge auditorium, looked down at the group of students down in front of me, and I preached, without a doubt, the worst message of my life. It wasn't just one of those things where a preacher's being hard on himself, where he says, I could have done that better, it sounded better in my head. It was one of those things where after I finished preaching, I had someone walk up and shake my hand and say, hey, thanks for trying. Not a good time. I was so tired, I couldn't string things together, I felt like I was choppy, I couldn't keep my train of thought, and I remember finishing that message, turning around and kneeling at the chairs up there on the platform and thinking, God, there were four other guys that could have preached tonight. Why me? You're trying to teach me humility, Are you trying to teach me? Why me? Why tonight? It wasn't what I would have picked. It wasn't how I would have planned it. But I realized that it might not even have been about me. You see, the end of the next semester, the last missionary program, I had a college student walk up to me and hand me an envelope. And inside that envelope was this letter. And in this letter, they said, "I just wanted to say thank you for running Missionary Prayer Band." And she named the message that I preached in the text. It said, "I just wanted to let you know that message you preached at the beginning of the year is still fresh in my mind. God used that to call me into the full-time ministry and to burden my heart for missions." Wow. And I read that note, and I thought, surely she must be thinking of some other message. It couldn't have been the one that I was thinking of. And a little bit later, another college student gave me a note and said, "I just wanted to let you know that message you preached, God burned my heart to surrender to missions that night." And I thought, how? I couldn't have gotten anything from that message, and I preached it. And God touched my heart and said, "I didn't have you there for you. You were asking all of these questions. God, why am I here? What is this about? What are you trying to teach me?" God said, "It wasn't about you. I had you there for someone else." Amen. As I look at Paul sitting by himself in Athens, it would have been really, really easy for him to spend that time saying, "God, what am I supposed to learn from this? You're trying to teach me something?" Honestly, having a little bit of a pity party. Even if you could have called it introspection. Right. Focusing on himself a little bit. But I'd like to look in the next few minutes at the three choices that Paul made in Athens that allowed God to use him when nothing seemed like it was going as planned. When nothing seemed like it was how he would have chosen it, how he would have planned it out. And yet he made three choices that allowed God to use him in that situation. The first thing that Paul chose was to look past his situation. Look in verse number 16. The Bible says, "Now while Paul waited for them at Athens, his spirit was stirred in him when he saw the city wholly given to idolatry." You see, he could have spent all that time focusing on what was going wrong and looking at everything that had happened to him and contemplating all of the problems that he had had, but he made a decision to look past his situation, to look up, and he saw people. And he saw people that were wholly given to idolatry. He saw people that needed a Savior. Amen. It's so easy to get focused on ourselves, to get focused on our trials. We heard that message on Sunday night about our pause. And how easy it is to get focused on our little schedule and catching up on little things and completely miss what God has us there for. So I've talked to so many teenagers who I believe were missing God's will for their life because they were focused on the situation they were in. They were focused on their family or the dad that God gave them, or they were focused on what they didn't have. I've talked to a lot of church members who I believe God could use them in a lot of ways, but they were too focused on their career or the things that they were doing, and they missed the whole reason that God had them there because they were focused on themselves and the little things that were going wrong. And they didn't step back and ask, like I've heard my dad ask 1,000 times, "I'm looking for the why. I'm looking for why God has me here. Not always about me. Who am I supposed to be reaching through this?" Choose to look past your situation. I remember going hunting with my dad. And all growing up when I was little, you know, walking behind him, and you'd always say, as you've heard 100 times, "Step where I step." And I remember being so focused, stepping where he stepped. But then the year came. I was 12 years old. I had the tag. I walked in front with a gun, and I looked at him and said, "You step where I step." That's how I felt anyway. And it was my first time. And I remember, now it's my choice to where we step and where we go. And I remember thinking, I'm going to be the quietest 12-year-old ever. Now, if you knew me as a 12-year-old, you know that is quite a hill for me to climb, because I was not a quiet 12-year-old. But I thought, I'm going to be the quietest walker ever. And I am looking down at the ground, and I am trying to miss leaves and twigs, and I am walking as quiet as I can. And I remember, and my dad probably remembers this too, a point where Dad hits me on the shoulder, and I look up, and there's a buck that goes over the hill. And I thought, I was so focused on what I was doing, on walking quiet. I wasn't out there to walk quiet. Right. I was out there to get the buck. Right. But I was so focused on walking quiet that I missed the whole reason that I was there. You know, right now it's easy to wake up in the morning, grab your phone, look at the news. What's going on with COVID-19, the coronavirus? To constantly be checking, okay, how many cases around us now? To be so focused on our situation. To be so focused on, well, I was going to do this, but I don't know if I could do that now because, you know, social distancing, and I'm all about being safe and taking precautions. But there's a point at which it's so easy to focus on our situation. I mean, this is something that none of us 2 months ago or even a month ago would have dreamed we would be in this situation. And yet we have a choice. Do we look at our situation? Do we focus on what's going on and what's happening around us and the situation that we're in? It was easy for me on deputation to think of everything that could be, of the meetings I could have had, of the percentage that we would have been at right now if not. And then I had to stop and say, you know, I can focus on that all I want. But if God's going to use me, I'm going to have to stop. I'm going to have to look past all that. I'm going to say, you know, it doesn't matter what meetings I could have had. What matters is where God has me now. What does God want for me right here? Amen. And church, I know it's easy as a missionary to think, oh man, this is my livelihood and I don't have my meetings. But then I stopped and I looked around and I realized a lot of you, your livelihood's put on hold as well. Yeah. It's not just about me. Right. It's not just something that's happening to me. And I think for all of us, if we stop and we look past our situation, we're going to see people that need encouraging. Amen. We're going to see church members that need a phone call. Because you couldn't slap their shoulder and shake their hand on Sunday and say, hey, it's good to see you. How's your week going? Right. If you'll stop and look past what's going on with your work, you're going to see people who are in worse situations than you are, that didn't have that emergency fund saved up, that maybe could use some encouragement, maybe could use some help. If you stop and look past our situation of everything going on, you might look at a neighbor who's scared. You might look at someone that you work with that doesn't know what's going on, and for the first time, you have an opportunity to say something for God and them actually listen. But none of that happens. And God can't use you at all if you don't make the first choice to look up and see people as Paul saw people wholly given to idolatry, and his spirit was stirred within him. Will you look past your situation? Secondly, the second choice that Paul made was he chose compassion instead of sympathy. Look back at verse number 16. Now, while Paul waited for them at Athens, his spirit was stirred in him when he saw the city wholly given to idolatry. And how we know it's compassion is the next verse. Therefore, because of this, disputed he in the synagogue with the Jews and with the devout persons, and in the market daily with them that met with him. You know the difference between compassion and sympathy? Is that compassion will always drive you to act. Amen. Compassion will always push you to do something. It would have been easy for Paul to look up and say, man, this is a superstitious place. One historian said of Athens at that time that it was easier to find a god than a person. There were so many gods in Athens. There were so many idols. There was so much superstition. He could have looked at them with sympathy. Man, but for the grace of God, there go I. It's so easy to look at people and think, man, I sure am glad that I don't have to weather this situation without a church family that supports me, without a comforter in the Holy Spirit, without the Bible that I can go to for hope and strength every single day. I'm so glad I don't have to live without that. That's sympathy, looking at others who have to live without that, feeling bad, but compassion is a different animal. Compassion will cause you to do something about it. I remember being in Congo and being in a little tiny concrete room that I was staying in. It was a Saturday afternoon. I was getting ready to preach at the little chapel the next morning. And I remember outside of the hospital hearing this crash and people start screaming. I jumped up from my room. I ran out and up the little
sidewalk to the main road in front of the gates of the hospital. And there on that road, two motorcycles had hit each other in a motorcycle accident. And in America, when two motorcycles run into each other, you generally have two people hurt. In Congo, they stack a lot more people. I saw one motorcycle with four people and a pig. So they stack a lot more people on each motorcycle. And so as I ran out there, I see just two twisted motorcycles, glass broken from the windshield, and then just people laying all over the ground. People are screaming. There's blood on a lot of people. A lot of people are hurt really bad. And I remember running out with one other guy. One other guy from the hospital. And the hospital was low that day on staff because it was a Saturday. We didn't have too many patients. We'd sent a lot of people home. And I remember going through and doing a little bit of triage, trying to find the person that was hurt the worst that I could help. And I was going person to person, and I found the driver of one of the motorcycles was hurt really bad. He was unconscious. There was blood coming out of his ears and his nose and his mouth. And if you've ever tried to lift a completely unconscious, fully grown man by yourself or with just one other person, you know that's very hard. And then trying to do that in such a way you don't hurt him worse. We don't have those gurneys that drop down to this high in Congo. You have to lift them to waist height. And I remember calling out. There's people standing everywhere. And off to this side, there's a group of motorcycle taxi drivers in their 20s. They're all this guy's coworker. They work with him every day. They all know him. And they're standing there looking at this. And I started calling out, please, please help us. Help us get him back in. He needs help. And I remember looking over. They're all standing there. Their arms are crossed. And you can see it on their face. They're all thinking, boy, this is terrible. Can't believe this happened. And then I see the guy in front go. And he turns around. And he walked away. Wow. And the whole group walked with him. Every one of them was thinking, sure is terrible. Sure is awful that this happened. They all had sympathy. But not one of them showed any compassion. Not one of them was willing to do anything because it would have cost them something. Getting involved, having compassion requires having sacrifice. Yeah. Getting involved requires doing something that will cost you. I think of the Good Samaritan. He got involved and it cost him money, it cost him time, it cost him convenience, but God used him to make a difference. Right. God used him to show his love to a man. One man said, I do fear, dear friends, that we are, many of us, getting into a very easy state about perishing men because we stay out of their way. To stop your ears to the cries of the hungry or to shut your eyes to the needs of the widow and fatherless is not the way to relieve famine, nor is it the way of doing good in the world to avoid the haunts of the poor and leave the dens of desolation and sin. It is ours to touch the leper with our healing finger, not to shrink from his presence. It is ours to go out and find the striped and wounded and helpless sons of men, and then to pour in the oil and the wine. Leave the priest and the Levite, if they will, to pass by on the other side. Your master asks of you, Christian, practical, personal service, and your Christianity is worth nothing unless it makes you heed his word. Amen. God asks of us compassion. God asks of us not just to look past our situation, but when you see people that have needs, that are struggling, when you see people that God has given you the ability to influence, you the ability to help, not just to look at them with sympathy. Sure is terrible there in that situation. Sure, I'm glad that our Savior didn't look down at us and think, boy, I gave them a chance and they messed up. They're in sin and humanity is on their way to hell. I wish they hadn't chosen sin. Wow. Wish they hadn't messed up. Sure, I'm glad God didn't look at us with sympathy. But God commendeth his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. You see, God has looked on us with compassion. And if God's going to use us in this time, when it's not something we would have scheduled, it's not something we would have planned, it's not something that we would have picked. If God had said, hey, do you want to work your schedule for 2020 like you had planned on it, or do you want to take a break and be quarantined to your town or your city or your house? I don't think anyone would have said, oh, quarantine, great, let's cancel everything we had going. But we still have an opportunity for God to use us right now. Just because our state is shutting down doesn't mean God did. Yeah.
Amen.
Just because we can't travel doesn't mean God doesn't want to work.
That's right.
And you know, God's business is essential.
It is.
It doesn't grind to a stop because the governor puts out a executive order. God's work is still going on.
Amen.
We have a choice. One, to look past our situation. Two, to choose compassion instead of sympathy. And lastly, Paul chose to act with boldness. Look at verse 18. The Bible says, "Then certain philosophers of the Epicureans and of the Stoics encountered him. And some said, 'What will this babbler say?' Others, 'Some, he seemeth to be a setter forth of strange gods, because he preached unto them Jesus and the resurrection. And they took him and brought him unto Areopagus, saying, 'May we know what this new doctrine whereof thou speakest is.'" And as you know, they bring him to a place called Mars Hill. Now, Mars Hill, if you don't know much about Athens, it's easy to think this is a place where they get together and they argue about religion, which they did a lot of that. But Mars Hill is so much more than just a place to get together and talk. It is the most feared courtroom and tribunal of their day. Its very name, Mars Hill, is from Greek mythology, where their Greek god was, one of their Greek gods, was in court against another for a murder of one of their other Greek gods in mythology. Its name comes from a murder trial. And in that courtroom, they would give verdict and give sentence on everything from murder to blasphemy. This is a place where you can get into trouble really quickly. And with Paul's track record, for the last two places that he's been, "I'm going to go, I'm going to run for my life. I'm going to go, I'm going to make them mad, and they're going to try to kill me." This is a place where it'd be really easy to turn down. "You know what? I appreciate the opportunity. Now, thank you for inviting me, but I'm going to gratefully pass on this speaking opportunity." This isn't a place to treat lightly. This is a place that could get Paul killed very quickly. And Paul has a choice. Now, he sees that God could use this. He sees that God could work through this. He's looked past his situation. He sees that these people need to hear, as he says later in the chapter, about the unknown God. The God that they don't know of yet. They have all of these false gods, but they don't know about the true God. The one that made them, the one that loved them, the one that sent his son to die for them. And they need to know of him. But it could cost him a lot. It's a lot of risk. And it's not something that's easy to just say, "Yeah, I'll do that. Okay, Lord, if you want to use me this way," it's something where you say, "Lord, this could go really bad." But Paul chose to act with boldness. And he got up in front of those men, regardless of the mocking, the jeering, regardless of what they said or what they did to him, because he saw that they needed to know of a Savior. And that if God was going to choose to work through him, he was going to choose to let him. And he chose to act with boldness. You know, it's easy to look at that and think, "Wow, what a great missionary. Wow, what a great man of God." But then when God gives us the opportunity, when God puts us in a position to talk to that boss, when it could cost you something in your job, when God puts you in a position to talk to that friend, though it likely will cost you something in your relationship, do we act with boldness? Or do we say, "Lord, I see that you've arranged this and you set this up and even through these circumstances, but I don't know if I can do that." I remember one summer coming back from college and getting to go with my dad to a hospital visit. And it was one of those visits where the person we were visiting was in Mercy Hospital in ICU. And it was a time where, because he was a pastor, he could go back in and visit them. But I got to sit outside of those auto-locking doors in the waiting room. And I'd grown up doing that. I was used to that. And I was sitting there and waiting for him to come back out. And while I was waiting for him, I saw those double doors burst open and a woman come out, take about two steps to the left of those doors, put her back to the wall, and just slide to the floor sobbing. Just kind of crumpled. Sitting in that room, I looked over, And God started working on my heart saying, you need to talk to her. You need to go talk to her. And I started arguing with the Holy Spirit. God, obviously, she's having a moment. She probably doesn't want to be bothered right now. Probably doesn't want to be disturbed. And God said, go talk to her. You need to go talk to her. I thought, Lord, you know, my dad could come out at any minute where he's going to want to be ready to go. I'm going to be in a conversation. And the truth is, it felt awkward. And for whatever reason, at that moment, I didn't stand up. And I was working myself up to do it. I was getting ready. I was kind of thinking about what I would say when I walked over there. When she stood up and she walked out of the hospital. I've never seen her again. And I will never know what God could have done through that situation. What God could have done through me for her in her life right then, if I would have just had the boldness to stand up, to walk over to her, say, I see you're hurting. Can I pray with you? Is there something that I can do for you? Can I tell you about someone who's helped me so much when I was hurting? If I would have just had the boldness to be used. You know, God wants to use us. God wants to work through us. Even in this situation, God has a plan for each and every one of us. And especially in this situation, I believe God is opening opportunities to witness, opportunities to be an encouragement, opportunities to be a blessing that probably would have never been opened outside of these situations. But we'll never get to see those opportunities turn into fruit. We'll never get to see those opportunities turn into saying, hey, look what God has done through this situation. Look what God has done. Look what God got to use me to start. If we don't look past our situation. If we don't choose compassion instead of sympathy. And in the moment, when God opens the door for you to do something, if we don't choose to act with boldness, God wants to work. God's still working. The question is, will you let him work through you? Yeah. In everything that's going on, there's so many opportunities. Will you be creative in looking around, looking past the thing that you've always done, to opportunities to do something new, for God to use you in a situation that you wouldn't have chosen? I hope that in a few years, we can look back. And we can look back at more than just the toilet paper bought and the time spent. Right. In quarantine, and how many shows we watched, and how bored we got sitting in our living room, and how we walked more in our neighborhood than we've ever had in the 20 years that we lived there. I hope we can look back at this and think, remember that time when the coronavirus went crazy and everything shut down? Remember that time I got to witness to my boss and he never would have listened, but he listened that time? Remember how big a deal it was to that church family when we just called them on the phone and prayed with them and talked for a little while and encouraged them? I never thought it would have been that big of a deal, but they keep talking about it. I hope that in 2 years or in 5 years, we can look back and we can count the things that God has done through us because we made the same choices that Paul made when things weren't going as planned. Let's pray. Father, I pray that you would use us. I'm so thankful that when everything else shuts down, you don't. That you work and you want to work and that your Holy Spirit is working in hearts. That you want to use us and that you've given us so many opportunities. Father, I pray that we would look past what's going on and we look past the news and our situation and what our work is doing and what our family dynamic is, Father, but that we could look past and we could see people and we'd see them with compassion and not just sympathy. I pray that you would give us the boldness to act for you and that you would use us to do something for you in this time. In Jesus' name.